Hey guys and girls, this is Anish from gainmedialab.com. Welcome to my exciting world of live audio mixing. In this video, I talk about why graphic EQs are getting such a bad reputation. But before we do any of that, make sure that you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss out on any of the new videos that I post every week on Mondays. So with all that said and done, let's just start the show. There's a growing number of system techs and sound engineers that will start telling you that graphic EQs are really not the best tool for either tuning your PA system, ringing out your monitors, or for general use in the audio world. I sort of subscribe to this mentality, and I will try to show you why I think graphic EQs are not the best solution on your digital console for all your audio work by doing some measurements in Smaart. So without further ado, let's just jump into the computer. We have two channels here, channel 28 and 29, both having pink noise applied to them. 28 is the channel that will get the graphic EQ and the parametric EQ applied to it. And 29 is just the reference signal for Smaart, which you can see on the right-hand side of the screen. Whatever frequency changes we apply to the EQ will be visible in the magnitude window of Smaart, and whatever changes will be apparent in the time domain will be visible in the phase part of their GUI. You can see we have the measurement and the reference channel coming in. Both channels are time aligned, and we can check that when I make a change on the graphic EQ, it becomes visible in Smaart. So now that we have everything set up, let's just go ahead and apply a change to the graphic EQ and observe what happens to the signal itself. I've lowered 1K on the graphic EQ to minus 15 dB, and that can be clearly observed in the Smaart measurement. So we have the same minus 15 dB present, but take a look at this width of the Q of this particular notch. You can see at about 1/3 of the octave, we're still minus 3 dB off. So we are affecting the neighboring frequencies of the center frequency that we have chosen in the graphic EQ. Let's capture this trace so we can have it ready for us so we can compare it later on. So this is GEQ at 1K at minus 15 dB. Let's reset the graphic EQ and try to do the same thing with the parametric EQ on channel 28. So we will apply 1K minus 15 dB at the narrowest Q, which is Q10 on the parametric EQ of this particular console. It doesn't allow us to go exactly to 1K, but the nearest frequency is going to be 990.9. And we can see how much more precise we can be with the parametric EQ when we apply the highest Q possible. That means that we can allow more frequencies to pass through the audio path, retaining a fuller signal to our users. It could be, you know, people wearing IEMs or monitor wedges or whatever audio application you're using these EQs from. Let's take a comparison at minus 3 dB. So when we use the parametric EQ, at minus 3 dB, we are at 860 Hz with a graphic EQ 750 Hz. So you can see the difference of just how many more frequencies the graphic EQ is affecting when we apply these notch filters. Let's save this trace so we can have a comparison for later. So this trace is going to be parametric EQ at 1K minus 15 dB. Okay, now we have both these measurements in Smaart. Let's do another comparison test. We are now back to normal without any EQs applied, no time difference between the measurement channel and the reference channel. And we are all set to do another test, which is going to be a bit different scenario. I will take a look at what happens when we have a couple of these filters bundled together. You know, the same way that you would have when you try to apply a graphic EQ to tune your PA system, where you are following, let's say, a curve that you want to have. So let's go back to the GEQ and again set the 1K slider to -9 and both of the adjacent filters to -5 dB. Remember, the center one is at -9, set on the graphic EQ. Now let's take a look at what that actually does to the signal in Smaart. Remember, we set the center frequency to -9 dB, but when we take a look at the measurement, it's at -11. The reason for that is that the Q width of the adjacent filters is so wide that it actually affects the center frequency as well. So when you have two adjacent filters, they will actually influence each other and give you a different result in the measurement or in the signal than the one that you are viewing on your graphic EQ. Let's capture this trace. So this is going to be graphic EQ, the center frequency at 1K at -9 dB, and both adjacent frequencies at -5 dB. Okay, let's reset the graphic EQ and go to the parametric EQ. Let's turn on the frequency. We said 1K, but at -9 dB. And we can just try and replicate this particular curve or this particular width of the graphic EQ so that we sort of have a representation how wide it actually is. So when we get to -2, we are in the ballpark, but you know, the center frequency stays at -9 compared to the graphic EQ where it changed on its own when we added the adjacent filters. Okay, so let's go back and try to recreate with the parametric EQ what we have done with the graphic EQ previously. So having three narrow filters very close to one another in the proximity of about 1/3 of an octave. So we have the center frequency set at 1K at -9 dB. So the next frequency over is going to be 800 Hz. Set again at the narrowest Q at -5, and another frequency set at 1.25K, again at -5 with the narrowest Q, so we can observe what happens if we have the same scenario set to the parametric EQ. Take a look at how differently this looks in Smaart. The center frequency that we have set at -9 dB remains at -9 dB with the two adjacent filters not influencing its magnitude because their Qs are just too narrow to influence the center frequency that we have chosen. And also the adjacent filters stay at -5 dB, so it does exactly what we told it to do, right? It doesn't affect other frequencies. Plus you can see just how much more audio signal is left in the path to towards the end user. Let's capture this trace so we have a comparison between the parametric and the graphic EQ. So parametric EQ, center frequency at -9, the adjacent frequencies at -5 dB. Let's hide the transfer function trace and compare these two traces. So the red one is the parametric EQ and the green one is the graphic EQ. And you can see just how different these two traces are. So the question remains, do all graphic EQs behave the same way? And the answer to this is absolutely not. And you should measure just to figure out how your graphic EQ is actually performing and what it does to your audio path. Now, the users of Behringer X32, the console on which I am performing these experiments, will know that it has two different types of graphic EQs built in. So we can take a look at what the second one, the TruEQ, looks like and how it compares to the graphic EQ. Let's hide all of the traces from before, enable the transfer function, and also disable the parametric EQ so that we don't have anything left in our measurement path. Okay, all of these filters go out. We are now back to a blank trace. Let's start with the same center frequency. So 1K, let's bring it down to, let's say, -9, and just look at how this already looks completely different to the graphic hue curve that we have used before. You can see those bumps on each side of the center frequencies. At full tilt, at minus 15 dB, this is even more prominent. Let's compare it to the graphic EQ. The pink trace is the graphic EQ. The green trace is the true EQ. And you can see how differently these two graphic EQs affect the signal that is ending up at your user for monitor or at your system when you are tuning the PA. So it just behaves differently, but none of them actually do what we would expect these graphic EQs to do. So just provide a narrow notch filter at 1K. They are still both quite wide, but the true EQ a bit narrower, yet adding, you know, different frequencies to sort of accommodate for that and to account for that Q narrowness by affecting the adjacent frequencies. Let's do the same experiment that we did before. So the center frequencies at minus 9 and the adjacent frequencies at minus 5. And this is what True EQ was actually designed to do. So it was designed to not affect the center or the adjacent frequencies. And we can see that the center frequency stays and remains at the set value of minus 9 dB. So the adjacent frequencies do not add additional magnitude to that particular filter. But it still affects the sound a bit differently than what we told it to do by doing these bumps at the edge of the adjacent frequencies. Compared to the parametric EQ that we have applied earlier, we know that the notch filters are exactly where we wanted them to, and we still get more signal retention when we use the parametric EQ versus the graphic EQ. And this is the name of the game. As a sound engineer, I always want to have the healthiest signal present at the end of my path, and I don't want to have any tools affect the signal in a way that I don't want it to be affected. Now that you have seen how graphic EQs compare to the parametric EQs and what they actually do to your sound signal, the question remains, should you be using them? Well, the answer is yes, but only if you have to. In my opinion, the graphic EQs are the last resort in the battlefield of monitor engineering or system EQing when everything else is sort of used up and you don't have any more tools at your disposal. I'll always start shaping my sound by using the parametric EQ, and if something is really, really bad and I just need that extra bit of tools to try and fix that, then graphic EQs are the tools that I will go for. But I always opt out for the parametric EQs first, just because I want to have more control over my sound. That's what it all comes down to. Graphic EQs will give you less precision and it will give you less remaining audio signal in the audio path. And that's something that I always try to avoid. My mission in life is to have the most frequencies in the signal path as possible, the most wanted frequencies. And using graphic EQs will disable me to be very precise about that, and sort of cut away a lot of the frequencies that I might want to have present in the audio path, but cannot have them because it's such a blunt tool. It comes down to control. Parametric EQ will give you more control over what you're trying to do versus the graphic EQ. Now, is that like a law and you shouldn't be using them? Absolutely not. Use your own discretion, use your own ears, and of course, in the battlefield that we all know as the monitor mixing world, everything goes, you know, as long as it cancels feedback, as long as it makes the artist happy. Use your ears, use your judgment, and use the knowledge that you have gained in this video to make an informed decision on what tool you will be using and when. This was it for this episode. Thank you for tuning in. Let me know in the comments below whether or not you are using graphic EQs for your work. And while you're doing that, you can also like, share, and subscribe to this video. And also make sure that you check out gainmedialab.com for more audio deliciousness. Take care, make great shows, stay safe.